You're welcome.
To the barber shop.
You're welcome.
To the barber shop.
Episode 206, get your fix at barbershoppodcast.com. It is your source for the very best in live original music, coming to you from Boxo Studio in the great city of Hamilton, Ontario, under the shadow of the Hamilton Mountain. We bring you real people, real music, and we do real good every Wednesday night on Twitch TV. And you can find us on YouTube, and you can find us on iTunes. Find us anywhere if you try a little bit. Barbershop Podcast, three
just
words.
Gotta look hard.
Just not even looking hard. It's like three words. Barbershop Podcast. If you're a follower and a fan, share it with someone else. Just like we do every week, we showcase fantastic music and the fantastic people who make that music. And we put a little bit of a Hamilton spin on it. I don't know what we call a Hamilton spin. I'm sure both of us have been down that road a few times, Ryan Cannon.
I think it's in Urban Dictionary.
Yeah, you've...
The Hamilton
the
spin.
The Hamilton
I
spin.
I give her the old Hamilton spin.
This is a fun thing.
Yes.
Music is a fun thing. How are you doing, Ryan Cannon?
I'm doing great. I'm doing awesome. Should we talk about the campaign a little bit?
Let's talk about the campaign a little bit.
We're doing amazing.
You're also in the monitor. Should you be? Or?
I should be in the monitor.
Okay, good.
Everybody needs to hear me.
All right.
Yeah, it's not all just an internet land. Yeah,
everyone pay attention to here. The campaign.
Everybody in the room needs to hear.
We're 1 week into our campaign.
I moved my channel so everything sounds better. We're 1 week into the campaign and we've officially hit our camera budget and now into the light budget.
The light budget. And then the $1,000 for the upgraded video card for the cameras to use, and
the
it's,
cameras are happening.
They're it's a process
happening now.
Very soon.
And now it's just the spice that's left. So we still need your help.
We still need your help to get there. You know, as good as this show is, the $30 webcams got to go, and they're going to go soon. And
we're still me and Gary will still have a $30 webcam.
Yes,
though.
Yes, we're not getting crazy here. But yours truly and the musical guests are going to have. They're going to look as good as they sound. That is our goal, is to make this show as professional as we can. Certainly the talent here is world class, and we would like very much to also look the part. So get on Barbershop Podcast Facebook page. You'll find the campaign in there. Go to GoFundMe, Barbershop Podcast. Go fund us. Throw us $25. Throw us $50. Throw us $100. Throw us $10. But it all goes into
everything
a pile,
matters.
And it's all for the betterment of music. Live original music, art, sustains us all. And that's part of the core message here at Barbershop Podcast. Music is much more than an economic driver or a distraction, although it can be those things. It is a life force. Music as an agent of change. And I have to admit, musicians tend to be pretty interesting people. They have the ability to boil down the big things into small things. They kind of make a jam out of the mixture that is life. They do that for a living, and they make for great gifts. Quite often, some of the sweetest, empathetic people, and quite often highly damaged and entertaining in that in that way anyway. And I love them all. Everyone who's been on here, the over, I don't know, 400 musicians who have been in over the four years. Coming up on our four-year anniversary show, right?
Big anniversary show.
Who would have thought?
Lots of guests, the old, normal, every single year, the same thing we do, house party, awesome. Who knows what's going to happen?
Who's going to happen? And there's no way you can get an angle on it because it happens a little bit different.
We don't know who's going to be here. We don't know what's going to happen.
We don't know.
It just happens.
We let it happen, and it's always magical.
Yes.
So that'll be Wednesday, November 30th, a very special episode of Barbershop Podcast, our four-year anniversary show. Hope to see you there. Well, we're going to do it again. We're going to do some more great live music, and I am so jacked about having tonight's guest in the studio because he was one of the old-timers, someone who I've followed and admired for many years here in the Hamilton music scene, and he came in here with Anna Timmons and Kori Pop and laid down a beautiful rendition in the early days of the very seminal, the beginning, the baby steps that was a record, that was a series of records, that is a musical vision. vision being fleshed out. And here we are probably 3 years later, and the record collector is here himself. Bill Majoros is in studio. He's going to talk about the project, the labor of love that he's been pouring himself into, the process to get there. And you're going to hear what it sounds like. And he's brought Mr. Steve Eggers in from the Nines, who's a longtime musician, a friend of Bill's. And I love it when it's a stripped down version, when there is an orchestral arrangement that is somehow channeled into a couple different individuals. Looking forward to the sound tonight. How are you guys doing?
Great. It's a pleasure to be here. Yeah. That was a very inspiring...
Don't have to talk in that mic.
Oh, I don't? Oh, okay. Okay.
You got the clip-on mic?
Oh, no. This is just for my...
I like the fact that you called him an old-timer. So
I know.
Yeah, but
I
he doesn't.
You didn't call me an old-timer. So.
But Bill looks the same age as 27. He maybe looks 29, but that's about it. Was there a deal with the devil involved to be so... virile.
Well, have you seen Phantom of the Paradise?
Yes,
with Dorian Gray, Faust, perhaps.
Ah, yeah.
But
it's not a Paul Williams thing.
A lot of Paul Williams. Yeah, he's got quite a Paul Williams collection.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Of dolls.
Absolutely.
Paul
I love Phantom. Phantom of the Paradise. Absolutely.
Phantom of the Paradise.
No, it's so great to be back. You know, like you said, it's wonderful to be able to kind of. Take things. We've been spending a lot of time in the studio. I haven't played live very much in the over the summer, mostly recording and with my own project, the Foreign Films. And then Steve's an old buddy, a real old timer over here.
Yeah,
but we're both spring chickens, actually. Steve's had a band I've loved for years called the Nines, and lately we've been collaborating. So it's been great cross pollinization, right? That's the great thing about the city. There's so many. Everything's interwoven, and we've been having a blast working together. So we thought we're going to be doing a show coming up. So, you know, we thought, well, why not try it, you know, experiment here, or use you guys as guinea pigs? Because this is new for us. We've never done these tunes before and actually played together ever.
No.
Really.
No.
This is a premiere. Barbershop podcast, yeah.
This is a premiere.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, we'll see how it goes. Well,
a continued evolution. Let's talk about that. When you came in, you were just some of the songs on. First of all, let's talk about the record collector. Was it an idea that you have strived to flesh out, or have you kind of let this project progress naturally?
Well, like basically the record collector is the end product is going to be a three vinyl set, and it's the work that I've done basically over the last 5 years. So it's been an evolution of usually about basically I've released a side of the album, if you're thinking old school records, a side at a time, sort of in reverse order, funny enough, maybe like the way the Star Wars movies were released. But I think side four, side three, and at the end, I'm just in the process, I'm gathering it all up and finally pressing the vinyl, and it'll be out in the new year at this point. But it's been great because it's almost like working on EPs or mini albums, and it's all part of a bigger process.
And I've loved that because there was always a pageantry involved in music, and the dropping of a record and the collecting and the curation of a record collection, and what that meant to so many people, something that's been lost over the years with downloads, and it's just a series of and to build were you conscious of the fact that you wanted to inject that kind of feeling of almost statesmanship in music?
Well, you know, I think as a music fan, I just always look to inspiration for the records I love, right? And a lot of the records I personally love are the ones that you can really delve deep into them. When I was a kid, I remember hearing like Stevie Wonder, Songs in the Key of Life, a double record, or the White Album, or Quadrophenia, where if you choose to just hear one song, like, I mean, things these days, it's almost like a soundbite, like, okay, here's 30 seconds, great, that's cool. But, and I understand that, but for the people that want to delve a little bit deeper, you know, you give them that opportunity. And to me, it's just always, you follow your own your inspiration, like whatever you're interested in. And when I was a kid, I just remember the excitement of going to a record store. It's like, oh, cool, you know, here's whatever. Here's Revolver, or here's Good Vibrations by the Beach Boys, or the Rolling Stones, or any record that you love as a kid. And if you wanted to just buy the single, that's cool. But then if you wanted to delve deeper into it, right?
Yeah, there's a story there.
Yeah, there's a story. And so I love the process so much. So it it wasn't like there was a gigantic grand plan or anything. It's just I love working on songs, and then I started to realize there's a little bit of a thread of continuity, right? Mm. And a little bit of a storyline throughout. And it sounds a little lofty or pretentious to say a concept album, but I like the idea of a string of ideas through it. Harry Nielsen, The Point. There's a lot of records that have that out there, but I just wanted to basically follow the inspiration that when I was a kid opened my mind to a universe of music. And again, I love the process. So, you know, it's interesting along the way, you never know what the future is going to reveal. And I just try to work with people that are like-minded and love music. And Steve and I, for example, Steve has had a band called The Nines for years. And back in the day, I was playing in a band called Flux. Actually, it even predated Flux. It was a band called Universal Honey, which was a couple people from The Pursuit of Happiness. And we used to do shows together back in the day. And, so from that point on, I always loved his records. So we just sort of found that we were at a similar, you know, came to kind of a nice crossroads. Yeah. And again, it's just following that inspiration, right? So he contributed to some of my new record. And likewise, he'd been doing some fantastic music. And to me, it's just all about just being inspired, right? Yeah. And digging deep and trying to, you know, do the best you possibly can. And, you know, even if it's just for your own personal journey. And of course, you hope that other people might like it. But it's just about inspiration, trying to find the inspiration. And as you get older and as, you know, life can get complex, you know, finding that, you know, follow your bliss is not always that easy, right? Mm. You got to dig deep and kind of keep trying to be inspired. That's all it's about. It's just ultimately, rock and roll, having fun, you know. Wow, that's a weird effect on there. Sorry.
It's important to make people
space rock.
It's important to, you know, before you engage someone here, you have to kind of engage their butt and make the. It has to be a musical journey, right? And something I'll say about the music, and this may have been what attracted you to what Bill was doing, is that it harks back to a style of pop music where there's a pageantry, but it's lush and it's beautiful and it's well kind of directed. It's not frivolous. It's not just all icing. There's definitely some cake involved. Was that, you know?
Yeah. I think like Bill and I, like I said, we go back, right? So we have a lot of similar interests in terms of music being conceptual and being albums being kind of a work of art, which is that sounds kind of, you used to talk about lofty and pretentious.
No.
That sounds pretty pretentious too, but I do see there's I think both he and I share that kind of vision where singles don't live alone. There's a continuum that kind of there's a concept that brings them all together. Mm-hmm. And musically, I think we just have a lot of similar interests. So
yeah, absolutely.
We get along really well in terms of playing together. So that's, you know, I think that's a key ingredient is a chemistry that you have with the person you're working with, right?
Because that comes through even the subtleties, you can tell. Yeah. Sometimes that tension plays a bunch of different ways. And I think that's one of the beautiful things about music and musicians, because they notice the subtleties. Someone in the audience will feel and hear the end result, and it may be a nuance they don't notice but I tell you, it's very distinctive when you are, it's like making love or dancing or kissing, you know.
Yeah.
It's,
well, we do that too.
You do that too, because it's
so it's all tied together.
It's team building, you know, really.
No, true. It's true. People know sincerity, I think, right? Yeah. Like, since you believe it or you don't. For sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
All right. The first, what are you going to play for us? What's the first live song? Is there a story connected to it?
I'll play one on my own first, and it's the multi-talented Steve Eggers will join me on a couple tunes after. This is a song called Junior Astronomers Club.
All right.
It's going to be early on the record, like first or second tune. I guess, like, to sum it up in a nutshell, I just try to to, I love cinema. So, you know, someone asked me just the other day, like, where the name The Foreign Films, where did that come from? And yeah, I think as a writer, I just try to envision stories, and ultimately we're storytellers. Right. So this is just a little story that go ahead. What were you gonna say?
No, I get to intro it. Don't forget.
Oh, okay, you get to intro it. Yeah, absolutely. So. And this came from just as a side note. There's a short story that I was working on with a writer from Los Angeles named Bob Rich. It's a story called Emily Blue and the Star on the Moon. And it's a short story kind of in along the lines of, again, Harry Nielsen, The Point, or almost a kid's story, Yellow Submarine. And this is one of the songs that came out of that idea. You know, just creating your own little imaginary world, basically.
Wonderful.
You know?
And writing a song and fleshing it out, you're going to hear it right here, right now. Junior Astronomers Club, Bill Majoros, Foreign Films, off of the record collector, right here at barbershoppodcast.com.
Towards the stars, wishing for a lucky day, and tape tangled cassette wouldn't play the silver starlight of a heart. Victoria's day, flip the single, let the B-side play. Love's bleeding in her heart, she'd say the silver starlight of a heart. She was a chapter, a tragic book of love, a star-crossed lover's love. Said, according to the horoscope she'd read, according to the lonely life she'd led, a silver starlight in her heart. Low is low to high tide, old river to the dark seaside. Yeah, you know we were so lost inside, the silver starlight of her heart. She was a chapter in a tragic book of love, a star-crossed lover's love. Junior Astronomers Club meets tonight. Junior Astronomers Club meets tonight.
Junior Astronomers Club meets
Junior Astronomers Club, Bill Majoros, Barbershop Podcast. Fantastic. You know what else is fantastic? Our great sponsor over at Hamilton Artists. HamiltonArtists.ca, Urban Hamilton Artist. Doesn't matter. You can find them on the internet. They're at 627 Main Street East, right there by Sanford. So you can find them on the street. They have an incredible showroom where you can go in and see the biggest things and the smallest things when it comes to printing something, when it comes to printing anything on anything, and you know, probably challenge them, and they'll take you up on it. They can do t-shirts, hats, mugs, hoodies. If you're a band, if you're an organization, you want to get your name, your message out there, you're certainly going to need some product to do that. And they certainly have helped us out, rocking some Barbershop Podcast t-shirts, flying out the door. You can follow the links, get yourself one of those, get your own message hooked up. They got a great machine. They do laser etching, so you can put your own face on the back of your acoustic guitar if you want. Hold it up, be all amazing. But the technology is incredible. You combine it with artisanship, and you get a great product. And they have it over at hamiltonartists.ca. All right. Bill Majoros is in the house with Steve Eggers, and they are playing their own brand of rock and roll. Rock and roll being kind of a blanket term for, you know, well, we know it's a euphemism derived from coitus, you know, just leave it at that. But anything that you can relate to coitus has got to be okay.
It's okay with
us, with everyone in here. So putting labels on it can be kind of restricting, right? You just kind of play what sounds good to you and
absolutely
what feels good to you. But as you said, when you're putting the record collector together, it was an evolving process. It kind of found its way. What are we going to do?
And it's interesting too, like in this context, like a lot of these songs have are typically pretty orchestrated, right? Like there's,
yes,
you know, strings and horns and all sorts of, so it's like stripping it down, like, you know, I haven't played this live for a while, so it's a good challenge to kind of go, oh yeah, what are those?
It really is a core, you know, of the song you have to search for,
yeah,
sometimes.
Gotta, yeah, yes, you got to go back and kind of, you know,
showcases the song in a, yeah, different, yeah, in a different way.
Yeah,
I
yeah,
guess,
so
right?
It's a good challenge, right? It's a good challenge to kind of go, oh yeah, how does that, you know, it's almost like deconstructing it.
Pretty
or something.
Girl with that much makeup on, right?
It's nice. That's right. You know, take the makeup off and she's still beautiful.
Exactly.
Absolutely, yeah.
Still beautiful.
And that is true. But something, when she's beautiful and you put the makeup on, ah, killer. And you got to hear with your record. We're going to listen to Teardrop Town first. Anything you want to tell us about that song?
Well, let's see. There's wonderful background vocal from Kori Pop. It's almost a duet more so, and again, a storytelling song, appropriate for this time of year with Halloween just passed, because it's a bit of ghost, a bit of a ghost story, and I'll leave it at that, and you know, your imagination can fill in the blanks. But Teardrop Town.
All right, you're gonna hear it right here, right now on barbershoppodcast.com.
Teardrop Town, where the sunshine is rare. She moves like a ghost with her blood red hair. If you cast the gaze of her eyes, eyes blue, a wicked eastern wind will put a curse on you. Yes, two hearts are better than one, but in Teardrop Town better off to run. Teardrop Town, full of crooked grace. Sweet revenge lies in a sweet embrace. Disappeared into the deep dark sea. Yes, two hearts are better than one, but in Teardrop Town you're better off. Cry, cry, cry. And the moment when he found out why,
the knife into his heart, just a watch him die.
Yes, two hearts are better than one. But a teardrop down, you're better off.
Teardrop Town from Bill Majoros. He is a stalwart. He's been around for a while, and he's always done great music. And it's progressed because it hasn't kind of sat comfortably in any preordained or prefabricated position. You've always kind of been evocative of a movement, of a sound or something, but you've always kind of taken it and ferociously put your own spin on it. So let's talk about pop, because I'm dating young these days and I've got daughters as well, so I'm listening to a lot more pop music than I had in the past, you know. I listened to album oriented rock for many years, and then just only local music. Mm-hmm. And now I'm getting back into listening to pop music. But I've always, as a producer, found it beneficial to scan through listening.
Are we talking about more modern pop at the moment?
Yeah. So I'm talking about the evolution of pop, because pop's just short for popular music.
Sure, and
a lot
absolutely.
Of stuff we consider classic music was just pop at the time.
At one time.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So how do you see, like, the first of all, the mantle of pop and pop's place in music, and is there any kind of connection or affinity that you feel necessarily towards pop music to be a standard bearer for quality pop music?
Well, I think it's, these days, it's a bit of a shattered mirror in terms of all the different genres, right? Because you can find, you know, there's so many great bands that are operating just under the radar that are drawing huge crowds. I mean, you know, like the Flaming Lips, or like, I love Annie Clark, St. Vincent, you know, she's a great guitar player, great. And like, I think to the average person, they still might be slightly outside the idea of like, a pop artist, in terms of, you know, selling millions of copies. But the thing, like you said it earlier, it's fascinating that these days, if someone can sell 40,000 copies on their own, you can have a really great career. You don't necessarily have to sell the millions of units. And I think there's all kinds of great people that are operating in that realm. Calexico, Wilco, all these people that we've talked about all the time. I think that's, you know, again, that's not necessarily straight up mainstream pop, but I do think there's some great things going on, you know, like people like Daft Punk, and there's all sorts of people that kind of fall in, that creep into that. Even, you know, some, like, I was just thinking about the tapestry of pop music and the chameleon-like traits that I find appealing to people, like someone like David Bowie, right?
Yes.
He's, you know, huge pop, or Prince,
yes.
right? Like, I mean, those guys have carried that all the way through, and you can see there's all kinds of great, like, very often I'll hear, like, a modern hip-hop song.
Like a Bruno Mars or Pharrell or any of these guys.
Yeah, Pharrell's a good example, and you'll hear Prince, and you'll hear in a lot of the new indie bands, like, you'll hear elements of Bowie and so forth, right? So, You know, I try to, I listen to music from whatever's exciting. That's it. You know, it doesn't have to be, even though I do gravitate to, you know, I'll be fixated on, you know, 1960s soul music or 50s rock and roll or 60s or 70s psych or whatever. But I really believe the music is still very much alive. It's just more of a fractured mirror of genre. So you got to search a little bit for it, you know, and you can find great things. A friend of mine's record that I played on, I've had a good year, like playing with the Nines and the Foreign Films, my own record. Another friend of mine, Greg Vickers, has got a project called Afternoons in Stereo, which is more sort of psychedelic, funk, jazz, groove-oriented music. And he's opened me up to a whole world of sort of modern soul music that's not generic at all. Yeah. Very, very creative, very innovative, and not just cookie cutter, right? Yeah. So,
and if it's quality, it tends to find its following, right? People get excited about it still.
It really does. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And like you said, people like, you know, whatever, Pharrell or whoever, there's cool
these,
people.
These
doing
guys
things.
Are like, the thing is, and I mean, we get this a lot too. So there's a lot of times what you want to avoid personally, like what I want to avoid. And I know Bill's the same way, is kind of being trapped in, you know, the past is the best and the new stuff doesn't, you know, is not as good or whatever. Cause then you start sounding like your
dad,
father.
Yeah.
Right. And it's a natural tendency to do that. But, you know, even on the top 40 stuff, like that's why we're saying, like, even there's some stuff that's not really great, but there's stuff like the Pharrell stuff.
If you hear a good song, you know it.
It's just,
and it can
yeah.
be, the arrangement yeah. can be simple. It can be stripped down, but it's an earworm.
Yeah.
And the next day, it still sounds okay.
Well, and again, if it communicates to people, right?
Yeah.
And it's not, you know, great music should communicate to all sorts, various generations, right? And just because it might not speak to me, it might really move a kid who's just getting into music and they hear, you know, 15-year-old kid or a 12-year-old kid that hears something that's really cool, and they don't have to know the reference points. It doesn't matter. It just opens that door. And again, if they choose to go deeper into that world of music, it's there.
Even better.
But, you know, I try not to judge. I try not to be too, it's easy to be cynical about it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I believe some of the best music could be made tomorrow.
I agree with you 100%. You know, and it's, as long as I see there's a lyric that got through to someone about the, you know, how precious and how short life is, and how you have to make the most of your life. And I see it going through on a kid who's only 11 or 12 years old.
Right.
That's making an impact when they're, you know, the last thing they should be thinking about is don't waste your life.
Well, there's that track 7 years old, which
that's what I'm talking
about.
Yeah,
I knew you were thinking that.
Yeah.
So that's almost like a bit reminiscent of the Sinatra track, which is the, you know, when I was 17, it was a very
fine year. I know the Sinatra track. I don't know.
Yeah.
The new
so,
one.
So
similar thing going through the years, I guess.
But it's the same idea, right?
Yeah.
And it's funny, like you know, because we talk. I think you were saying, you know, you hear this sometimes, and I know my daughter loves that song too, and it's meaningful.
It's
right?
meaningful
to them,
and you can see there's a light goes on.
Yeah.
It says music is a book that I can dig. You know, I'm gonna learn something, and it's my little secret.
That's right,
absolutely. And like you said, life is short, and so you gotta, you know, in my humble estimation, follow what you find inspiring, and not worry so much about, like, what people think of it, or it's nice to get good feedback. Don't
get
me wrong.
You'll never get anywhere if you worry about what someone else thinks.
No, you gotta follow your own star. Mm-hmm. And interestingly enough, like you said earlier, your podcast has fans all over the world, right? And sometimes, you know, you might find even locally. I mean, Hamilton's always been great to me. I love Hamilton. It's amazing. But I find, and you're in a similar boat where a lot of the music I do is not necessarily, it gets really great response in Hamilton.
Yeah.
It's great, but most of it
needs to find its audience elsewhere.
Yeah, and most of it's elsewhere, and that's cool too. But ultimately, it's just sort of about a personal journey. Like, do you enjoy playing the drums right now? Do you enjoy, you know, writing down some lyrics? Do you enjoy, sometimes you got to fail too, right?
Mm-hmm.
You got to write you know, 10 crap songs to write one good one, yeah. right? And yeah. You got to try. Like, even now, we're trying all these songs. Like, we're just, you know, trying new stuff. And, like, it's just like, you know, it's exciting for me. And I think that's it. If you can continue to be engaged, right, like in music yeah. or just in life. And sometimes easier said than done.
Yep.
But, you know, you
got to... You will not lose as long as you keep getting up.
Yeah, right? yeah. You that's just right. keep working Do at that. It, right? And follow the
follow
inspiration.
Follow your passion.
Yeah, yeah it's it. True. It's true. Because that comes across when if you're... It doesn't matter. Again, going back to if you're kissing or if you're playing. If you're phoning it in, they know. They know you're phoning it in. You can't phone it in. Yeah. No. Not in this business.
And that's what's cool about you even, you know, having this sort of canvas for artists to come in. And it's appreciated, right? Because it gives people a great, just an opportunity to first of all, you know, put their songs together and then get it out there to yeah. the world and
in a different way.
In a yeah. different way, yeah, yeah.
In
so
a different
it's,
way. I've,
you know, and I love I really the fact that it. There is a intimacy that's building. Our people who love the show love the fact that it's real. They love the people who come on because they're real.
And it's also a good challenge too, because we were talking about earlier how these days with recording, with splicing and dicing and modern recording. You don't get a chance to so many people, and not that it's a bad thing, but in modern recording, you know, you'll take one little bit and loop it and loop it, and okay, you do it, you know, you play that that one drum pattern once, and then you loop it over and over again. And that's another art form, and that's totally cool. But in this format, it's a real challenge to
put up or shut
front
up.
To back, and if you make a mistake, well, that's the way it goes, right? That's life. It's in the moment.
Forever.
Right? It's a forever.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
We actually were going to do, we thought it would be funny if we actually came on and brought just a keyboard and pushed one note for a good 20 minutes.
A new techno
just and just say, this is our song.
This is, yeah. yeah. People might not be ready for this
no.
yet.
Yeah. No.
Well, you're going to cool. do it. You're going to do a couple more live
yeah,
ones.
We'll do,
what
do,
are you going to do next?
Well, Steve's going to join me on this one. This is a new tune. It again is part of the my collection, the record collector, which is again, like I was saying, you know, ultimately a vinyl collection of three records and kind of a compilation of work I've done over the last 5 years, I guess. This is one of the newer songs that's going to appear on the album.
What's it called?
It's called The Drive-In.
All right, here you're going to hear it right here, right now on BarbershopPodcast.com.
She never cries. Ocean-colored tears, memories of the years pass by. Thunder in the rain, falling on the pain. Songbirds will sing so high. Lightning flashes to the sea. You and me are gonna be alright. Come on, darling, hold me tight. You and me are gonna be alright. Do you wanna go to the drive-in show? Do you wanna go? Do you wanna go to the drive-in show? Do you wanna go? City girl, starling in a swirl, sings a tune. Yes, we'll dream again, stardust in the rain. Oh no, we'll save our vow. Lightning flashes to the sea. You and me are gonna be alright. Come on, darling, hold me tight. You and me are gonna be alright. Do you wanna go to the drive-in show? Do you wanna go? Do you wanna go to the drive-in show? Ooh.
sweet sonic sensation of Bill Majoros.
That's bass.
The sweet bass.
Sweet background vocals.
Yeah, sweet Stevie Higgers. Sweet Stevie Higgers.
That's my new name.
I'm actually
sticking with that.
We've given quite a few names out here.
Sweet Stevie
Higgers.
Yeah.
From here on in.
Yeah.
It's been labeled it. Now.
All right. You know, it's true. It's real live music right here, and that's something that you can soak in. Everyone,
absolutely.
I'm talking to you out there, sitting in there. It's great that we can bring this to you. It's great that we can bring it to you in the comfort of your own home as you're sitting there with your jammies on, stuffing your face with Pop-Tarts or whatever's going on. That's between you and the snacks. However, you should get yourself out. Go visit a live music venue at least once a month. If you're not a regular purveyor of live music, it is available, not just on Friday, Saturday nights, not just at 2 in the morning, not just with half-naked people screaming and yelling and partying and doing stuff in the back alley, although that stuff does happen. Like, I mean, that's part of a lure. But you can go. There's open mics.
Yeah.
There's blues nights. There's jazz nights. There's Tuesdays, Wednesdays. You can go 9, 8:30 sometimes, you know, just go check out and support live music.
Absolutely.
If the place you go to has live music and you like it, tell the owner, I'm here because of the live music. I like the live music. If it's a place that you go to because it's convenient and you like their kitchen and you like their bar staff, you should say, you know, you should have some live music in here. Do your part to make this scene happen. Because
frankly, it's really,
I think we have a problem in this industry is that, you know, in many ways, although, you know, there have been periods and individuals who are able to, you know, show a realistic face. It is quite one that's based on appearances and quite often.
Which we have.
Yeah, which you have. But, I mean, in the industry, it's not cool to be hurting or to be bitching or anything like that. So, you know, as someone who is involved in playing and promoting and doing music, it is a shrinking market. And it's not because the talent isn't out there. I'll tell you, if you think that there's no good new music out there anymore, you're crazy. And, you know, people of all ages making incredible music. And,
totally agree. Absolutely.
Just difficult for them to find the venues to play. And when they do play, it's difficult to get the numbers to support it. And quite often people just, you know, don't know when it's happening, where it's happening, or they haven't been exposed to it and haven't caught the fever yet.
Yeah.
And that's something that if you're someone who's caught the fever, make someone else catch the fever. Be like Typhoid Annie or come here.
Watch it on your computer. Well,
there you go. On the computer, there's 205 episodes. 205, I think, six maybe. A lot of episodes, different kinds of music.
And thanks for having me back, too.
Oh, I've been wanting to for a while. This is it's nice because now we have the mighty Apollo 16 and the beautiful Soundcraft K2, and it's all,
it's a beautiful
studio.
And thanks for letting us debut some tunes.
Oh, it's a pleasure.
Work the bugs out.
Yeah.
Pleasure to have you in here.
Absolutely.
All right. The next tune we're going to play, or it's video, another video.
Oh, okay,
we've got some great videos. Uh-huh. This is Girl by the River. Is this this nothing about finding a decomposing body. Sort of thing, right? This is like a good one.
Teardrop Town. There's a bit of a murder. There's a bit of a Quentin Tarantino sort of
where they find the murder.
This is potentially. Yeah. You can use your imagination. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, hidden clues in all the tunes.
I love getting extra value in your music.
Absolutely.
And check out the video. All of Bill's videos are great, and visual art is part of art. And having the opportunity to do it on stage or do it on videos is definitely
thank you. And this was a rare. It was a nice opportunity on this particular tune. Again, I have a tendency to, even last time, Anna playing cello and use a lot of strings and use a lot of orchestration. And this is one of the few tunes where I take that back. It's acoustic guitar, and I'm going to throw in a bit of an emotional angle to this. A friend of mine who's an arranger was an amazing arranger from the Netherlands, and forgive my pronunciation, Wim Oldjiak. He passed away recently, and he was an incredible. You've had some contact with Wim.
Yeah.
He did a lot of the arrangements on the record, and a really renowned guy all throughout Europe, a peer of someone like Van Dyke Park, who did all the Beach Boys orchestration, was a huge fan of his. And he literally, it was one of those things, you know, it was a new experience for me because he did all the orchestration, and one of the wonderful things about technologies. We're communicating, sending tracks back and forth. And, you know, I'd send him a tune and he'd come back with this beautiful arrangement, cellos and strings, and just beyond my wildest imagination. And that's one of the great things about music is, you know, when you let it, just sort of let it go and you work with great people like Steve or Wim, you know, it would come back and it would be, wow, this great, you know, these beautiful, beautiful parts. And Carl Jennings, it's one of those stories that you almost couldn't write it. Carl, who's done a lot of the production, a wonderful guy, great musician who's worked with me on the record. Can't say enough about Carl, super talented musician. He was actually going to Holland, going to the Netherlands, and he planned to meet with him because we'd had so much communication, right? And you realize, like, going back over it, I've worked on like 30 tunes with this guy. I'd never met him in person, but right. You realize how close you get to someone, yeah. Right? And he was an older gentleman. He'd been doing this you know, kind of a legendary character since the 70s, right? And he alluded to the fact he'd been under the weather, but he was such an upbeat person that I had no idea of the gravity of it. And Carl was actually set up a meeting with him to go and have a coffee with him or you know, whatever you do in Amsterdam, I guess.
Socialize.
And literally, he was the kind of person that would get back to you right away, right? And it was sort of funny. I'm like, well, you know, I'd send him a message and like, Carl's going over, he's gonna, you know, like, you know, it's perfect timing. And I think they'd maybe had some preliminary conversation. And then a few days later, I found out he'd passed away and he'd had a chronic, he'd had obviously a really serious illness. Mm-hmm. And so this song, Girl by the River, is, when I think about it, really it's me, I'm playing acoustic guitar, but all the beautiful back, the orchestration, yeah. The beautiful stuff is Wim's work and an extraordinarily talented guy and an incredible inspiration. Like, you talk about inspiration, it's like what an incredible musician. And here's an older guy who was one of the most inspired and creative people I've ever worked with.
Open-minded.
Yeah. Wanted to work with, like, it. You know, by, you know, a young, by his standards, unknown, relatively unknown musician, and just put so much heart and soul into it. And
out of the love of music,
Out of the love of music.
Like, it wasn't, because you can deal with, I mean, everybody knows this, like, his caliber, he could be...
I couldn't afford it, yeah, right? Like, it was one of those, like, you could hire someone, and he just fell in love with the music for whatever reason, and, you know, it's humbling, and did so much work on the record. So, if you listen beyond my fumbling away on the acoustic guitar and pitchy vocals, you'll hear a beautiful orchestration. So
I love.
All right, so he illuminated the songs, and
I love his story. Thank you for sharing it.
Yeah,
and you're gonna hear the result. Girl by the River, barbershoppodcast.com.
Yes, boy, forgive her. Her beauty is timeless as the sea. The bells of the church chime, marking in real time. Sweet honey sunshine down on me. Wash our sorrows to the sea. We became sparrows in the heartbroken desert, drawn towards the river's edge. Wings tired and wounded, circling downward. Lions await at the shore. Wind was with us for one last victory. The cruelty of life takes its toll. Oh, ooh, girl by the river. believed in magic. Gods and devils, I still believe our love was true. We became sparrows in the warm autumn moonlight. No one could hurt me and you.
Another great video by Majoros, Girl by the River. Another great story. You got to get involved and invested in your community and the music that flows around it. Get in there and paddle. I'm going to give a shout out to, well, it's Gary's old lady, actually. But she's she's a sweetheart. She's a sweetheart in the way of like a shark is a sweetheart. She'll do right by you. And she'll do your taxes right. Knowing musicians, you probably still haven't done your taxes, okay? You need to get your taxes done early in the year, not in December. But if you get it done in December, then probably being a musician, you probably didn't make any money. So you'll have money coming back to you, which is a good thing. If you are a working musician, you might have a non-for-profit business going underneath you. You never know. There's lots of advantages that people in the industry don't know about. And Heather's been working with us special folk in the music business for a long time. So she knows the ins and outs. She is trustworthy, and she's done right by us. She'll do right by you. Taxes done right. There's a link. Go check her out. All right. Bill Majoros has come in with Steve Eggers, and they are playing music, and we're spinning some of their videos. It is a record collection. It is the Record Collector. It is a three record LP collection that'll be coming out. It is beautifully orchestrated and polished pop in the sweetest traditional sense, in that there are no rough edges on it, but that doesn't mean it's going to go, it doesn't mean it's lightweight. It's got depth, breadth, and it gives a good showing, I'll give you that much. And Bill has brought his untutable Gretsch into the, you know, a lot of people say, you know, Gretsches, it's like, oh, they're supposed to be like that.
He's got a Rickenbacker here, too. I think that's just for show.
Just masochist. In case.
That's just for show.
The masochist guitars.
I think we used that last time, yeah. Yeah, the Rickenbacker.
What are you going to do for us now?
Okay, well, we're gonna turn the mic over to Steve.
We've worked on recently,
I got to say, a prolific songwriter and one of my very favorite writers, at least in the room.
Stuff gets and done, maybe, right? Maybe of all time
of
this
all
week.
Time.
In the world. Yeah, in the world, absolutely. And really prolific. Like, this is off a record we did called Night Surfer.
Yep.
And the Cassette Kids.
Yes, which was a movie-esque theme too.
Yeah,
I love very ambition.
I think that's the tie-in.
That is the tie-in.
With Bill and I, we live in the movies.
There's been thematic records, and there's a new one.
Yeah, we have a new album that we're doing that's coming out through all the regular channels, called Alejandro's Visions, which is another movie-esque kind of vibe. So conceptual, I guess, in some ways.
Yeah, I think that's definitely one of the things that's tied us together is, like, you know, these
concepts.
Yeah,
you need a partner in crime when you come up with a ridiculous idea, the other person thinks it's funny, you go with it, you wake up the next day, you don't want to be the first one to say, that was really dumb yesterday.
And I mean, the thing is, as much as sometimes, you know, these things, they might, you know, these cinematic ideas might seem, again, kind of lofty, but we've just had a laugh with it, right?
Yeah.
Because the characters
fleshing
in the story...
Flesh it out.
Yeah, when you asked me a question earlier about Junior Astronomers Club, it's almost like, well, where do I start? Because like some of these, if you're writing character driven songs and you're a storyteller, they take on a life of their own, right? It's great. So
it's another platform for writing, right?
Absolutely.
So what's this one?
This one's called Never Take You For Granted.
Okay. All right, Never Take You For Granted with Mr. Steve Eggers on vocals. right
We're
here, right
some
now.
Nice heavy drums in this one.
Yeah, heavy drums in this one.
Okay. It'll be great. Go for it. Barbershoppodcast.com.
Maybe I don't say it quiet enough. Maybe I don't say it, I'm so tough, but I'll never take you for granted, girl. I'll never take you for granted, girl. And I say things that will hurt you now, 'cause I know that I am insecure, and I'll never take you for granted, girl. I never take you for granted, girl. I can talk about the things that I do and all the things I feel, but I know without you here I could not get through. Maybe I don't say it quiet enough. Maybe I don't have it all in tow, but I'll never take you for granted, girl. I never take you for granted, girl. I can talk about the things that I do and all that bring to you, but I know without you here I could not get through. Maybe I don't say it quite enough. Maybe I just am acting tough, but I never take you for granted, girl. I never take you for granted, girl. I never take you for granted, girl. I never take you for granted, girl.
Nice job, Mr. Eggers. That's Steve Eggers, who was singing so sweetly in background when Bill was singing, who took the lead vocals and sang up front. Love to hear that. Love to hear, you know, when there's different voices kind of playing together. It's is it something that's first time? Because I've been with people, I know people, we just sound good together. It's easy. And other people, it's a little more
rough.
Shoehorning to find your frequencies where you're, was it easy to sing together or?
No, I think like, it's actually funny because like Bill and I, we have very different voices, but they I think it works well. Like it's a nice kind of, you know, we play off each other.
Yeah,
we haven't done a lot of, I've sung a little bit on your albums.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
But now, hearing Bill right now, I think I'm going to have him sing more on my albums. I'm starting to feel, I'm feeling something here tonight.
Because you love my vocals so much.
I loved it. It was very sweet.
Thanks, man.
Very sweet.
Likewise. Yeah.
It is. It is good to see, because that is, again, something that can be, that was always a true test, and now you can fix it in the studio. Now you can bend it, now you can fake it, but not here. You know, not when you're singing live. You kind of have to do it.
You got to feel it.
You're warned about that.
Yeah,
absolutely.
He can't help it.
You know, he can't.
No, I'm just testing my gear. Sorry.
It's a nervous twitch. I'm turning mine off. Look at this. It's off.
Sorry, guys.
It's a technical cornucopia of wonderfulness.
All right.
Now, videos, it's when, you know, going up, you're going to be a proponent of the LP format. It's usually 10 to 12 songs, 22 minutes a side, pressed thusly. The world has changed a bit. Shorter attention spans, more visually oriented. We saw it with, you know, bands in general, where you had to be a looker, have at least a couple, you know, your front people had to be good looking. You could hide the bass player and the drummer if you had to, but yeah.
it became the guitar player.
It became like you could.
Oh, you said the bass
four
player.
Ugly guys can't do it. Like where back in the day, there was lots of great ugly bands that were attractive
because of their ugliness.
Exactly. And the people realize that rock stars always got to date like the supermodels, and you look at them, it's like, my goodness, you know, it's like they're very thin though. I think you can be hideous as long as you
yes.
are on the heroin. It's like okay.
Keith Richards,
He's looking good and thin.
He's actually looking better now.
He does look good.
I think if you have a certain barometer when you're on the ugly unattractive scale, as you get older, it almost evens out. So you're almost okay, like, because you don't change that much, right?
It's
as opposed
true.
To being beautiful when you're
it's
young.
True. It's true, but you have to, you know. I was going somewhere with this, saying that going from like the 12. And then the EPs became popular for a while, and now it's videos. People will produce a strong single in a video because you want to get people's attention, and it's becoming increasingly more
difficult.
Yeah, to do that. Are you any hard won lessons in the cyber world that it's a DIY sort of kind of going forward? I know I love seeing when you go on. You go to the States, you go to, South by Southwest, you go to conferences, you go to festivals, you go on tours, because there's a physicality that's still very important as well.
Yeah.
You have to be more than just an image that's being beamed around.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think that you just have to apply your enthusiasm to whatever you're doing, right? And just make the most of what you're given, right? And I think people appreciate, there's something to be said about just telling your own personal story, right? And whatever can augment that, that's cool, you know? And I often think, there's some bigger tours that we did back in the day where I've often thought, man, it would have been cool if I would have had Facebook back then, because, it would have been great to, But it is what it is. It comes and goes. I think the visual component, if you look at it in an artistic way, it can be an amazing thing. Like, obviously, it's like a little mini commercial for you. Yeah. You can look at it and go, oh, well, whatever.
You can't run from it.
So
you have to embrace it, right?
Yeah, but I mean, if there was a young band out there and they had great songs, why not try to come up with super cool images? And why not try to...
Posters and anything. Packaging of your record. Like, strive a little bit further.
Yeah, and if you have fun with it, I think that's the main thing, right? Ultimately, some of these things, I would love the record collector, the story, the Junior Astronomers Club, Emily Blue, part of the story. I'd love it to be a cartoon one day. It'd be fun if it was like a little short story, or some of the stuff we've worked on. It'd be cool if it became, it could be a screenplay for something. So it could also be a video, but a lot of times I think in long form too. So why not part of a soundtrack for something? And we've both done some soundtrack work too, right? Yeah. So I know that, both of us have gotten a little bit of mileage out of songs and films. Around Halloween, like years back, I had a song that was, Linda Blair from The Exorcist was in a Dan Aykroyd thing, and they used one of my songs in the background, and that got a lot of mileage for me. It was really cool to see it in that weird context. It's like, wow, that's that movie I was really afraid of when I was a kid. Now one of my songs is in it. How creepy and cool is that? And Dawson's Creek, you've had stuff on that show from the 90s, and as an art piece, a video can be a really great thing too. If you have a spark for that, or in terms of soundtrack. But I mean, I think there's no going back. If anything, it's almost like
and I think to this day,
maybe video game. It's not my thing, but I see people younger. The younger generation coming up, kids that might be 15 years old. They want something that's interactive, so I can only see music going in that direction further. And why not have it stimulate all the senses?
And creativity goes a long way. You don't necessarily need a budget if you're creative. If you say, okay, I have $200 as opposed to the $2,000 I wanted to do this video.
Yeah. But we've all seen multi-million-dollar movies that are terrible. And we've seen some great
indie films that are made on a shoestring, right?
Amazing, right? So the
it
idea
comes down to the writing. Always.
Yeah, the idea wins, right? And I also think and to me, good songs and good film, a lot of times it comes down to the motive. Like, why are you doing it? Are you doing it, because you're?
Does everyone buy in?
That's another thing too. And if the motive is
that's the catch, right? But you're right. I mean, it's usually people when things take off, it's usually because there's some type of spirit or emotional connection to it, regardless of the amount of money.
Yeah, absolutely.
Money helps in terms of getting it to more people.
Yeah. So well, that's a big part of it. Absolutely, absolutely. Right. But at the end of the day, it's the spirit of the idea, and whether it's film or like television or
the idea wins in the end. It does.
Now you got to keep. You know, we're in a society that rewards. You know, financial gain, and there's and that's fine. Like that's. Yeah. But at the end of the day, the idea wins, and it's just. I think all the best music and all the best film that I've ever seen. To me, you know, if you see an interview with the director or a musician that you love, usually the motives are pretty pure. You know, and the motive is to do something cool and creative, and you know whether it sells. Yeah. 10 copies or 10 million copies. It's got that same element.
Yeah, music's never created on commission, you know. Yeah. It always comes from the heart of the person doing it.
And again, when you go through your life and you spend days working on it, you just love what you do. And regardless, you know, we could be making a bazillion dollars doing this. And if your motives aren't genuine, you might hate it, right? So you got to love what you do, right? You got
to
love it.
There's lots of ways to make money if, you know, it's
I don't
like,
know any, but I hear there are.
Well, So I've heard. There's lots of ways to
listen,
do it.
Ken,
you have to have passion.
Listen,
let me tell you.
Sweet.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. Did we play a live one or on off the video last?
We did live.
Live,
we
all
did
right.
Live.
So we're going to do Empire...
Of the night,
which sounds like the 13th installment of Star Wars, perhaps. Yes. It meets Freddy Krueger, right?
I'm hoping it is. It's a combination of both those things.
Now, what's the spin on this one?
The title came quick. I was working with an amazing artist named Rebecca Everett. We played South by Southwest last year, which is great. I've been lucky enough over the years to do a lot of traveling with music, you know, and... you know, really, that's one of my favorite things about it is the opportunities I've had to, you know, everywhere, all throughout North America. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a lot of times, you know, it's not always in luxurious situations, but I've certainly had a chance to travel all over with great people, and I'm really thankful of that. So Rebecca contributed backgrounds to this particular song, and we played South by Southwest in Austin, Texas, which is an amazing music town. I see a lot of similarities between Austin and Hamilton, too, and I think we could probably learn some things, and vice versa. You know, it's great cross-pollination between those towns. And... I'd just say, you know, to sum it up, it was a great, like, that little period working intensely with Rebecca, the song came out of that.
All right. Well, here it is. Another great video from Bill Majoros. This is, you know, something that you got to check out. Look up Bill Majoros. I got a link there. Foreign Films, The Record Collector, or this particular one right here. Empire of the Night on BarbershopPodcast.com.
Spent all these years searching in the darkness for the light. Yeah. nothing in this world I wouldn't give to you. Here in the empire of the night. Yeah, I'm such a fun artist, pure. We're looking for a sacred cure. Here in the empire of the night.
Barbershop Podcast, Empire right. of the Night.
Well, and,
all right then. Another fantastic video from our friend Billy Majoros right here with Mr. Steve Eggers. I talked him into doing one more live number for us before bidding adieu this evening. What are you going to do for us? What is the name of this particular song?
This song's called She'll Reveal Her Heart. Oh,
we love when that happens. Mm-hmm. When you slowly peel back the chest cavity and look at the heart.
Yes.
You know, you thought I was going somewhere else.
Yeah, so did I. I was just, it seems to peel back. I got a little worried.
You went a little surgical there.
Yeah, a little surgical.
I liked it though.
All right.
But never know where the show could go late in the night as it goes on.
It's time to wrap it up. This is when Ryan gets nervous.
Yeah. And thanks so much for having us. Honestly, you guys are a great force in the city and it's a great opportunity to play. Yeah. And,
it was a great time. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thanks for letting us showcase some songs and work out some of the bugs and having fun with it.
It didn't sound very buggy to me. All right, so is there any short story with this one?
A short story. Essentially, I guess with this song, the inspiration, it actually, normally I kind of write music and lyrics at the same time, or even the music first. This came as it was actually written lyrically first. You know, I was thinking about these days with like how dark some of the politics are, and you know, some of the lack of grace in our particular age. You know, I try to look to people that are inspiration. You know, you think of people like Leonard Cohen or Bob Dylan or McCartney, all these elder statesmen. That are, you know, still doing some great, you know, great things and great lyricists. So, you know, this was kind of a stream of consciousness thing. And it was one of those, some songs you'll labor over for, you know, for weeks or, you know, months or whatever. And this is one I just kind of, it all came to me very quickly. Mm. And, but again, more in the form of, like more poetry, which is not typically the way I do things. And then the whole thing came together fairly quickly, and it's a nice one to go out on. So she'll reveal our heart. And thanks again so much for having us.
Our pleasure.
We're the Foreign Films and Steve the Nines. We're doing a show in Toronto coming up.
Yes, too. We have a show. Yes, we're going to plug it. So we're playing a show on November the 18th at what used to be called The Sister in Toronto. Mm-hmm. And I can't, now, of course, I'm going
to Well, we're going to have your link on the page, yeah, so people are going to be able to click that, and we'll know exactly where
right,
it is.
Yeah, and, awesome. Thank you so much for listening. I appreciate every listener. It really means a lot, you know, and look for the new record. If anyone's interested in vinyl, it'll be coming out in the new year. I'm really excited about it, and, you know, I really appreciate people checking it out and giving it a spin. You know, a lot of heart and soul's gone
into
it.
Two thumbs up, so. 5-star, thanks, highly recommended here at Barbershop Podcast. She'll reveal her heart. Bill Majoros, Foreign Films, barbershoppodcast.com.
Desert, she will bring you crystal water, lake in the valley where you first sought her. She'll reveal her heart, but you could only stare. When you're ready, boy, she will take you there. The desert, my father was a sailor. The sun and sea were holy, the true love wouldn't fail her. Four winds are blowing, dear, in the island of your memory. Where long forgotten moments live deep beneath the sea. Tangerines are growing in a Japanese garden, ancient fountains flowing in the heart of the desert, ancient buried treasure. There once was a deep sea, the weight that you carried. She reveals her heart, but you could only stare. Sunrise, she'll take you to a doorway in the valley of the sad eyes. She'll reveal her heart, but you could only stare. When you're ready, boy, she will take you there. For your sacred sins, boy, you will be forgiven. Dead where love lays dying, alive among the living. A nightingale sang on the lonely steeple, a melody of eternal spring for the lonely people. You dream of her forever, boy, till your dying day. She'll reveal her heart, and she'll take you away. This world to take you away. We'll be right back.
Don't we love a great love song? I know I do. What a great story. What a great night. Thanks for coming out, guys.
Yeah, great time.
Yeah, for you those guys are two guys, we love are. You guys. Thank you.
Every week we're fantastic. Woo. I'm fantastic. Ryan Cannon is fantastic. Gary Greenland is fantastic. And whoever is gracing our presence, you got to know they're fantastic. Thanks for joining us. Join us next week. Join us every week at barbershoppodcast.com. Have a good one.
Cheers.
Thanks, Woo. Everybody.
Thanks, everybody.